Let's go through the last couple of exercises that we have in the course. So we want to discuss now how to implement a dynamic voltage controller, so a classic droop controller to adjust either active or reactive power in order to raise the voltage in our distribution system. So the grid that we are using is the usual. So we have the main grid, the transformer, the cable, and the controllable load. We are starting from the same conditions that we had in the previous example. So we have 100 kilowatt and 100 kilovolt ampere as an initial load consumption at this point in time. And then what we want to do is that we want to add a new load in parallel with the possibility of adjusting reactive power in the first place. So we basically need to add the load and also design a controller. So what should the controller do? So we need to have a controller that is based, of course, on a certain measurement from the system, the voltage, with a certain latency. As usual, we have some latency in measuring, in transmitting the measurement, and so on. Let's take the usual half a second. An initial, let's say, output of the delay equal to 1 per unit, and I'll come back to this once we are in Simulink. Parameters of the controller, it should be a droop of 5%. The unit that we want to control should be actually 100 kilovolt ampere reactive unit that we can adjust. As you can imagine, since we are discussing about increasing the voltage, in this case, for a loaded situation, then we will, of course, deploy capacitive power. We want to activate the controller just after a certain amount of time, so t equal to 2 seconds. And as usual, observe the system, how is performing, and so forth. And then we repeat the analysis, but instead of regulating the reactive power, we actually modulate the active power. And let's compare the different result, whether we will obtain different result, of course. And as a last point, we will redo the same analysis, but basically having a cable that is 3 times longer. So this one is a 200 meters, so we'll just replace the cable with a 600 meter cable. Okay, so let's get into our system. So that's our usual system, main grid, transformer, cable, aluminium, 150 square millimeter, the load. Always remember to double check that the initial value of the load here is consistent with the loading values that we have here, if we, of course, are interested in having a flat start, which should always be the case. I already run the load flow. And just to be sure, this initial the initial value of the second load is a 0, 0. So basically, this one is not consuming anything. And right now, I don't have any set point given. So this one is basically, it's like if it was not there. So we just run the load flow, we get display the load flow result. In this case, I also run the usual 10 second simulation, just to double check and verify that also the voltage result from the dynamic simulation is consistent with the voltage value that I have from the load flow, as it should be. And we always have the usual set of measurement just to analyze the usual current voltages at the different points. Okay, so what we want to add on top of it? Instead of, let's say, adjusting an explicit reactive power consumption, we want to modulate the reactive power consumption of this new load based on system state, so based on a voltage measurement. So we need our proportional or droop controller. As usual, we will have input, so the state, the voltage measurement from our system, and a variable that we are gonna control. So in this case, it will be the reactive power in the first place. How is our controller structure? So it's always the same approach. So we have the measurement. The difference here, we have to remember that this one is a three-phase complex number. So we need to take, as usual, the module. We need to remember that we want to normalize the values, because it's always easier when working with droop controllers to use normalized values. So we need to divide by 400 volt, divide by square 2 because it's a peak measurement here, and multiply square 3 because it's a phase to neutral measurement. Our latency, half a second. Here, just to avoid, let's say, nasty transient at the beginning, I have an initial output of the latency equal to 1. But since the controller is not really working before 2 seconds, this value shouldn't really matter in the end. The reference, so I decide that at this point in time, I want to have a set point, so a reference voltage that is 1 per unit. So you see, of course, why we want to have a per unit value also on the measured voltage, because otherwise here we would need to have the absolute value, 400 volts in this case, or 231, so 400 volts square root 3. Then we have the usual error, so the difference between the two measurements, the controller gain, so our droop, and as we remember from the droop, from the scheme when realizing the controller, basically, we need to have 1 divided by the droop gain. So it's 0.05 because I have 5%. It's a minus because I need to have, let's say, I need to take in consideration that since for me, a positive power in this specific load, since I'm using the load convention, corresponds to an inductive power, I want to make sure that in case I have an under voltage, I need to have a capacitive power, so I need to reverse basically the sign here. Otherwise, as we discussed, it could also be an option to reverse the two signs here. But in the end, as always, once you design it and make it work for the first time, if it doesn't really do what it's supposed to do, that means that there is a sign that is reversed somewhere. The 100 kilowatt or kilowatt here as a basis. So basically, you could say this one and these two, they are all part of the proportional part of the proportional gain. It's just easier or better to have them split in such a way so that we can easily identify that this one is a 5% loop. And then we have a saturation here. Why? Because I want to, let's say, make sure that my load will not receive a set point that is larger than what it can actually handle. So in this case, the load can actually, I mean, doesn't really have a lot of limitation, but from a physical point of view, I want to model a system where I don't want to force the load more than its capability. And I decide that my load shouldn't consume or produce more than 100 kilowatt or kilovolt ampere reactor. The upper limit in this case is unnecessary because in the end we will always be working on a negative value here. But in case this was, let's say, a compensator that can provide either capacitive or inductive power, and we always have the assumption that 100 kilowatt or kilowatt is our limit, then there should be 100,000 here as well. And then this step is just to, let's say, enable. So it's basically just an on-off, just to say, enable the controller at t equal to 2 and don't do anything before. And then we have the usual states here. So remember to always have a good overview on the input, the error, and the output of the controller. So that's basically our system here. We can appreciate here that's the first half a second where there is no measurement coming from the system. Then we have the measurement from the system. Of course, we are not taking any counter action, so the voltage will just stay here. The error also will be constant, as well as the response of the proportional controller. But that doesn't mean that this one is actually affecting the system, because in the end, we are multiplying by something that is basically not really activating anything. And also another important thing, this line here is interrupted, so the signal is not really going anywhere. Okay, so what we want to do now? We want to basically plug, let's say, our controller and making sure it's gonna work. So we just rerun again. I don't need to rerun the load flow because I haven't changed anything in the initial values of consumption or generation of my system. So I'll just rerun it and then I'll see that hopefully, I mean, that was expected, we increase the voltage as we were hoping for. So what happened inside the controller? So we can appreciate here until t equal to 2 that nothing is really happening in the system because this output is basically disabled. Then after t equal to 2 plus half a second, because we have a half a second of a measurement delay, we see that actually our system start to respond, so start to take take an action. So in this case, it's deploying at the beginning the 100,000 kilovolt ampere reactive, and then it start to oscillate a little bit. Just to make things more clear, I think it would be also probably better at this point in time to plot the response both, let's say, once it has been activated and also before it has been activated, just to avoid confusion. So let's just put it here. And here, just to get it right, so that would basically be the Q reference that we are giving to the system. And then this one will be the Q reference based on the on-off system. Yes, so I'll just rerun it, this one. Yes, so we can appreciate better here that basically until 2 seconds, there is no response given from our controller, and then it starts to work as expected. So as you can imagine, I mean, it's a proportional controller, even though we call it a droop, it's not really changing its nature. So as all proportional controller, they can create oscillation in the system if the controller gain is too intense. We could still say that in this case, the intensity of the controller is still reasonable because, yes, we have some oscillation, but they are, let's say, they are under control and they are dampened quite well. So it would basically mean that it's satisfying the controller objectives. The voltage, we are how much are we raising? We are raising basically a couple of points, so 0.02 per unit. By deploying basically this amount of reactive power, so a bit more than 60 kilovolt ampere reactive. As always, we have to observe also the other system variables. So what we have here. So as usual here, let's have a look at the different currents. Actually, it's better if we just rerun the first second, so without having any controller on. So the initial current of the load is 214 ampere as usual. Here, as we remembered, we have 45 degrees of displacement between current and local voltage. There is no current from the other load, so that one is basically equal to zero. There is no, this one actually is empty. And this one is the resulting current in the transformer. So we perform our simulation, and then we can appreciate basically that the current in the initial load is decreasing a little bit because we are raising the voltage since the load is a constant power. We start to provide here this very large capacitive current, so that's 90 ampere with 90 degrees of displacement on the local voltage. And as a resulting current, we have a current that is let's say it's still inductive since from seen from the transformer point of view because we have this negative angle here, but it's definitely much lower than before because we are supplying basically a lot of reactive power locally. So that's the beneficial effect that we are achieving. So that's all good. So let's see now what's happening if instead of adjusting the reactive power, we say we adjust the active power. So I don't change the label here, but just be aware that right now we are controlling the active power. So it's important to pay attention to the load, to the voltage, and it ends up that basically the voltage is pretty much the same that we had before. So also in this case, we're gaining a couple of percent. Also in terms of amount of, in this case, active power deployed, it's basically the same amount of power. And also looking at voltage and currents down here, we also see a reduction of the current, but we appreciate that the current that basically is coming from the transformer now, it's much, much more displaced compared to the previous current because basically we have a large amount of reactive power consumed locally and we are just supplying locally a lot of active power. So you could say in terms of voltage increase, it's more or less achieving the same objective as before, but in terms of, let's say, smartness of the solution, I would not really say it's the best approach because we have a lot of reactive current that it's not really necessary to have going around the system. But what somebody, let's say, could highlight is that in the end, even though we are in a low voltage system, basically we have the effectiveness of active and reactive modulation basically equal. So the amount of voltage increase in the two cases is the same. And this could be a little bit disturbing somehow, because you could say that we always need to remember this formula here, and we need to remember that basically in a low voltage system, we tend to be more resistive in term of comparing the amount of resistance to the amount of reactances, series reactances that we have in the system. That's correct, but we also need to remember that in this system, it's the overall reactance and resistance that that matters. So it's not just the cable, and even though the cable is definitely more resistive than reactive, we have the other two elements that are before, so the main grid and the transformer, that are heavily reactive. And in the end, if you do a few calculations, which are not too difficult to realize, you can appreciate that basically seen from the load point of view. So if you take the whole series of resistance of the main grid plus the one from the transformer plus the one from on the cable, you end up with a value that is 0.04 ohm. Sorry, here, 0.0474 ohm. And if you do the same with the reactances, then you end up with an overall equivalent reactance that is very much the same. That basically means that the X over R ratio of the overall system, so main grid, transformer, and line, is basically 1, which means, as a matter of fact, that the amount of compensation in terms of voltage that we can get with active and reactive power is pretty much the same. Just a small note, you will see that we have two voltage values here, so it's a 10 kilovolt and a 400 volt. So in order to do this calculation, I just reported basically the resistance of the main grid and the resistance of the transformer on the low voltage side, so that I can easily sum them up with the one from the cable. It's interesting now to just make a quick discussion on how would it be the situation in case we have a cable that is much longer than before, so 600 meters, so 3 times longer. So as expected, you can do the calculation then later on, we will get a system that tends to be much more resistive rather than reactive. So in that sense, we will have an X over R ratio that is lower than 1. It's not that much lower, but it's basically around 0.5. So we should expect actually reactive power control based on the voltage control based on reactive power being less effective. And let's just double check that. So I'll just get a longer cable. I'll take again here on the reactive power. Remember that now we change the system, let's say parameter of our system, so we need to rerun the load flow because we have a different system. So otherwise the Simulink will not update voltage values and so on. So it's important always to remember these small steps here. So that's the first one. Here, apply to the model, and that's it. And as expected, here we are getting a voltage that is much, much worse than before. Just to be sure that everything is working properly, we run the simulation for 1 second. So to verify that there are no dynamic, no transient in the beginning, and then we run the usual 10 seconds. And then what we see that our voltage is increasing. So that's good. We can also see here that we are basically deploying the whole reserve. So as a matter of fact, since the voltage is so low, given this droop value and given the reference value that we have here, then basically the whole reserve is deployed. And we end up with a final voltage that is 0.92. So what happened now if I change it to the power control? The voltage is higher, so as expected, I'm having a more, let's say, effective response. But we also need to pay attention actually to the values specifically, and we can actually appreciate that there is something, let's say, not really nice going on, because we basically have a response that is oscillatory. So what it means, it simply means that our gain in this specific situation, so with this specific voltage values and amount of reactive or active power that we are handling, it's too large. So the control action is too large, and that makes the voltage having an oscillatory behavior. So in that sense, it would not really be desirable to have this controller tuned in such a way for this type of grid condition. So it means that if we would have to experience this type of grid condition, we would need to actually, let's say, reduce a little bit the intensity of the gain, because it would not really be nice to have this kind of oscillatory response going on. In this case, we could just double the droop. So 10%, that basically means that since it's on the denominator, we are basically halving the intensity of the response. And we can see here the behavior. You can see that it's still quite oscillatory. So that's not really completely dampened, but it's, let's say, converging somehow. So also in this case, a 10% would also be way too intense. So let's say 15%. And then we do the usual tuning process. So in this case, that will be acceptable. As expected, of course, we end up in a situation that our effectiveness is basically reduced, because we have a more shallow intensity here in the droop. So we end up with a voltage increase lower than before. We end up with a deployment of reserve that is smaller than before. And this is something to take in consideration. So just to compare the value, so we have now a 0.91. If we then take it back to adjusting the reactive power, just to make a fair comparison, we end up here with a situation that with the reactive power, we have a lower voltage increase as we would expect, because of the higher resistance in our system. And that's pretty much for this exercise.